questions that have come up in the past, questions that bother women, men, young folks. Marriageable couples or people who are planning to get married, intending couples. These are some of the questions that pops up on the minds of some young ladies, and we are asking ourselves this question. So we're going to just jump into it. I'd like to advise our French viewers that we will be giving you the French version after talking about the English version. I will try to see how we can go between the both languages. Please, English speakers, bear with us because we want our French speakers to also understand our content and not have to struggle with dictionaries when we're speaking English. We have lots of French viewers who are viewing as we go through these questions and as God helps us to answer, to provide answers for these questions. So introducing ourselves, this is Princess coming to you from Canada, and we have a guest here. I don't know if she's a guest or she's a known face. We know her. We've been hearing from her a lot. And we are very happy to introduce to you Deborah, coming to you live from France. Let's jump into it. You want to say a word of?
Yeah, I'm coming to you from France, and we will be discussing a very important topic today. I hope you get a lot from this message and that you are going to be blessed. The questions are going to be answered, and then you'll leave this video, watching this video, blessed and encouraged.
Okay.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Yeah. Alors. Les amis, bonjour, c'est Princesse qui vient ici du Canada. Il y a Deborah qui vous vient aussi de la France. Et nous voulons discuter de certaines questions qui sont survenues dans le groupe. C'est des problèmes qui touchent aux jeunes femmes, aux jeunes hommes, aux jeunes couples. Il y a des questions qu'on se pose avant de se marier, on se pose certaines questions, on veut bien les aborder avec vous. Soyez patients, on va être assez bref que possible et on espère que vous serez bénis à la fin de cette vidéo. Alors, désolé, mon français est encore aimant. In English, the question that we are seeing a lot now, we're just paraphrasing it, and it says, can God lead me to a man with little or no resources? Can God lead me to a man with little or no resources? Someone who doesn't have enough, and maybe he's just managing, he's living in a one bedroom apartment, he doesn't have a car, maybe he has a very little job where he's just managing to go by, to go through the month. It goes from one month to another. And you wonder like, okay, if he's not feeding himself enough, how is he gonna feed me? Why should I marry this man? You're wondering. Yeah, we're going to answer them as best as we can. And I'll give the first word to Deborah, and then I'll provide also what I think, my humble self, and hopefully you'll be blessed. Go ahead.
So, the question goes, can one marry someone little or no resources? I would think that God can, he can lead you to an individual, a man with little resources, because he is really the provider. He is the one that can provide all our needs, and so he expects us to depend on him for every need we have. That is, every situation we find ourselves to be able to depend on him. Bible says that some trust in the chariot, but we will trust in the name of our God. Yeah, it is disheartening. Sometimes it's fearful for a young lady, a young man came to propose to you marriage, but you realize that this individual has little or no resources. And you are sometimes tempted to reject the proposal, or think God's leading for you just because the person doesn't have enough of resources. But as an individual and as a person, I would say that I always believed that a lady is a favor from the Lord. And if you are a favor, a sort of favor from the Lord, you should be able to believe that this brother will become better. He can get something, he can become better than what he is presently as a result of his associating with you. So a sister should come with this mentality that, yeah, he doesn't have, but is he a hardworking person? Is he someone that wants to work? Is he someone that wants to get skills? Is there anything that is hindering him? Sometimes it just could be that he doesn't have challenges, he has inferiority complex, he has just something that is deterring him from getting those resources. Or maybe he doesn't even believe in himself as much, just to maybe if he's looking to go and get a job, to present himself at an interview, he doesn't present himself correctly, and as a result he doesn't get the job. But you as a sister, you could be that encouragement. You could be the one to motivate him to say, no, you can aspire for something great, you can become great. And what makes a sister, you know, makes you really the favor that God brings into a man's life is that you pray for him, you encourage him, and as soon as he even comes into your life, he begins to see an exponential growth in his life. So that's what you cannot say when the Lord has led you, he leads the brother, and he has led you as a lady to marry this person. You will not say because he doesn't have resources, you'll say no to the marriage. Instead, you sit down and you plan. How do we go about this marriage? How do we make it possible? And you try to cut your coat to it yourself. I mean, you make sure that you don't spend more than what you can afford. You know, you don't pressurize your income so much that you cannot, you know, afford, or that after wedding or what have you have to borrow or whatever. No, make sure that you plan your life. But what all we are saying is that God is the one that provides for our needs, and that you are a favor from the Lord. And so that person, that brother, that man that is saying he wants to get married to you because the Lord has led him, he's convinced in his heart that you are the wife that the Lord has prepared for him, you should just go and pray and see if the Lord is giving you a go high. But please do not marry anybody because you pity him. Don't marry anybody for pity. You don't marry anybody because you want to do the person a favor. No, if it's because you want to do a favor, it's better you just put that favor out of the marriage. There's no need for you to allow yourself to be pressurized by that brother or by his friend or by family members or whoever, you know, to pressurize you into getting into this marriage just because you want to please him, you pity him, you think you are the savior. You are not the savior. You are not the savior, so you don't take the place of the savior. You make sure that you are really sure this is the right person for you. And at the same time, you also should make sure that you are ready to walk hand in hand with this person. You love this person also. Very important that you should love this person. A lot of ladies are falling to the hands of wrong marriages today just because they have pity on this person, and they thought they can save the person. They can, you know, stand as a savior. They want to salvage his poverty-stricken situation, and they have burnt their hands as a result. So my encouragement to you, my dear sister, is that the resource of the person should not be a hindrance. Should not be a hindrance, but two people that do not have any good income should not really come together because it's going to be a bit dangerous. It's going to be very strenuous on the marriage relationship. You as a sister, if you have something, maybe you have better resources, or you're working, you have income somewhere, then as a result you can help the family, then encourage your brother to take his position as the head, because he is to be the breadwinner, he's to be the one to provide for the food, and not you. So I pray that as we share these, as we talk about this, you get to understand all they were saying, and you would heed to this plea, our heart cry, that to see that singles make the right decision, they don't get into wrong marriage, and that they are happy in their homes.
Yes, I see some very important points that I was noting as you were speaking. And number one, God can actually lead you to someone who has little or no resources. That's a point that you've made really clear, that our saying yes to brothers should not be based on their status quo, should not be based on their income, should not be based on their family, should not be based on anything materialistic. Most importantly, marriage should be according to God's own leading. Okay, that's what we have always emphasized. Doing God's will is paramount for you to have a peaceful home. Okay, now if you say, can God lead me? You are agreeing that God is leading you. Okay, so if God is the one that is leading you, then you shouldn't be worried. So what am I saying? I mean, emphasizing that you need to make sure that God is leading you, not your emotions, not your feelings, not the words of people, not desperation, not frustration, nothing of those things. You're not frustrated. You're not feeling, oh, you know what? Nobody's coming. He's the only brother that came. I need to become Mrs. Somebody. Okay, yes, I'll marry you despite anything. No, God is not leading you. If you are sure that God is the one that is leading you, you have prayed through and you are sure that God is saying, yes, you can go ahead and marry this man. Please feel free to go ahead. Another point that was raised was that if two people don't have any means of livelihood, like let's say both of you are not working, how do you start a marriage? Who feeds who? Are you going to go back to your parents and ask them for food? No. So I know that we have a lot of faith. Faith is good, but we need to be real. We need to be factual. Okay. The fact is that if you do not have a means of livelihood while you are still in courtship, look for something to do as much as possible. Like before you come together as a couple, make sure that you have something to do, something to get some food, because most times after a marriage, a baby comes around. In most situations, if you have a baby, what happens? How do you feed the third mouth? That's why you should make sure that you find something to do. You can be a compliment. You can complement the brother's resources. Let's say, for example, the man has little resources and you have a better job. Yes, you can marry that person if God is leading you and you know that you're going to be his helpmeet, also financially. You're going to try to help him to become better. Okay, maybe both of you will come together and start a business, or both of you will come together. Maybe you have more like ways, you know, you can help him to make his resume or CV better. You can help him to explain to him on how to go about getting a job, making yourself employable. And there are some tips that you can add. You add some flavor to his life. Yes, you can do that. Okay, so it's okay for you to marry someone who has little or no resources, as long as you know that this man is God's will for you. And the man also, talking to the brothers now, don't say that because of this video, yes, ladies, you can marry us like this, the way we are, they said it's okay. No, you make an attempt. I want to get better. I want to be able to feed my family. I want to be able to meet the basic needs of this lady that I'm getting married to. That's very, very important. As a man, you want to sit in that home as the head of that home. You want to be the one that leads, you know, in everything. God will bless brothers. But you try to think, find ways, try things, you know, try to get the business, try to get something that can help you to ameliorate your present state. So that when you get into that marriage, it's not going to be a marriage of sweetness at the beginning, and when there is need and wants, then issues start coming up. Okay, so try your best to find something else doing, and don't ever feel that, oh, I'm too big to be lectured by my wife. Lectured in the sense that she can help you. She might know more things than you. Maybe your wife has more experiences than you. Be humble. Be willing to learn something from your wife for the both of you to get better financially in any aspect of your life. So that's why you need to be willing to work together with that person. And note, don't marry out of self-pity. Don't marry out of anything that is not God. Okay? Don't marry out of any of those. Be patient. Be willing to bend to God's will. And that, permit me to read that verse. Psalms chapter 40 from verse 8. I delight to do thy will, O my God. Yea, thy law is within my heart. If you are willing to do God's will, you are willing to let God be the director, the leader of your marriage, then you are sure that you will not miss it in life.
Ben, je dirais que c'est possible d'épouser une personne qui n'a pas beaucoup de ressources, qui est peut-être dans une certaine sorte de précarité. Mais il faudra savoir que pour ces personnes qui n'ont pas beaucoup de ressources, surtout en frère, il ne faut pas l'épouser parce que tu as pitié de lui, parce que tu penses que tu es son sauveur, tu dois... sauter à son aide, venir à son aide. Non, ce ne sont pas des raisons valables pour épouser une personne. On n'épouse pas la personne par pitié, on n'épouse pas la personne parce qu'on est des personnes mettent de la pression, montent une grande pression sur nous, qu'on doit épouser cette personne et qu'on n'a pas de choix, ou à cause de l'impatience, ou à cause de l'âge. Et que c'est le premier venu, et donc on se dit non, je dois épouser quelqu'un. Et donc tu le fais, pas parce que tu l'aimes, mais pas parce que le Seigneur t'a dirigé, t'a donné une confirmation ou qu'il t'a vraiment dit, mais vraiment c'est ton époux. Mais tu l'épouses juste parce que tu as pitié de lui. Ce sont des mauvaises raisons, des mauvaises intentions de rentrer dans le mariage. Et en plus de cela, il aime. Très difficile que deux personnes qui n'ont pas de ressources se mettent dans une situation, c'est-à-dire dans une relation de mariage. Parce que le mariage vient avec des responsabilités. Et donc, on doit pouvoir subvenir aux responsabilités, aux ressources, aux responsabilités de la famille. Et donc, si les deux personnes sont sans ressources, ce n'est pas encouragé que vous allez dans le mariage. Il faudra d'abord avoir des ressources avant d'aller dans le mariage. Ça, c'est une autre chose. Mais sachez qu'une jeune femme peut épouser un jeune homme qui n'est pas riche, qui n'a pas beaucoup de ressources. Il faudra croire. La Bible dit que celui qui retrouve un mari, il obtient la faveur de Dieu. Et donc, tu dois te considérer, toi, femme, comme une faveur que le Seigneur amène à cet homme. Et donc, c'est à toi de prier pour cet homme et de l'encourager afin qu'il devienne mieux qu'il était. Mais nous ne voulons pas dire que les frères, maintenant, qui n'ont pas de ressources, puissent monter une certaine sorte de pression sur les sœurs pour leur donner des noms parce qu'elles ont dit non, elles ne veulent pas faire tout ça. On ne force personne à épouser. On ne force pas la personne à t'épouser. On ne force pas une personne. On ne met pas la pression. On n'utilise pas les choses religieuses ou quoi que ce soit, des versets bibliques, pour oppresser la personne afin que la personne cède et t'épouse. Non, il faut que ça, cette décision viennent d'elle-même. La femme en question, elle doit faire ce choix. Et laisse-lui faire le choix sans mettre de la pression. Pas la pression de la famille, la pression des leaders à l'église. Personne ne doit mettre de pression sur une sœur pour l'encourager ou la pousser, la motiver à rentrer dans cette union. Parce que le mariage est quelque chose pour la vie. Et donc, on ne doit pas être impatient et courir et donc pour rentrer dans cette union de mariage. Il faut être dans la tête. Prêt dans la tête et prendre cette décision sciemment. Ce que nous sommes en train de faire. Et pour ne pas jeter la responsabilité sur qui que ce soit. Donc, on doit prendre notre décision de nous-mêmes. Réfléchis, ma soeur, est-ce que c'est quelque chose que tu peux faire? Mais nous sommes là pour vous dire, chère soeur, chère jeune femme, que tu peux épouser un frère qui n'est pas très riche, qui n'a pas beaucoup de ressources, si toi, tu as peut-être des ressources. Enfin, ce n'est pas mauvais. Si tu as des ressources, tu peux être la personne à peut-être souvenir au besoin de la famille pour un certain moment. Ce n'est pas un mal en soi, mais le frère lui-même, il doit faire des efforts. On doit voir qu'il fournit des efforts pour prendre ses responsabilités. Ça, c'est très important. Le frère doit aller travailler. Il ne doit pas dire non, je ne veux pas faire ci, je ne veux pas faire ça. Non, tu dois faire travailler, te donner les chances à réussir. Toutes les chances à réussir. Et toi, la soeur, tu peux l'encourager. Tu peux lui dire, non, tu peux faire comme ça. Et sois frère, il faut être humble, recevoir de l'enseignement de ta femme, si elle veut t'aider, si elle souhaite faire quelque chose pour toi, pour que ta situation s'améliore, pourquoi pas. Et si vous pouvez aussi parler entre vous et planifier. Peut-être on va décider de le faire dans une année ou dans deux ans, quand tout sera stable financièrement. Pourquoi pas? On ne doit pas courir, on ne doit pas faire un choix dans une précipitation. Jamais faire quelque chose dans la précipitation. Non, il faut prendre son temps, prier et que le Seigneur nous aide. Et aide toutes les jeunes femmes ici dans ce groupe afin de faire un choix qui plaira à Dieu et surtout sachez que la raison c'est important que tu ne te maries pas et après tu perds ton âme à cause des situations, peut-être des querelles, des problèmes qui arrivent à cause des frictions dues à la responsabilité du mariage. Parce que quand on se marie, il y a plusieurs choses. On a besoin de l'argent pour prendre soin de la famille. Et donc, si cela sera un fardeau, ça ne vaut pas la peine. Il ne vaut pas la peine de se mettre dans quelque chose qui sera un fardeau et entraînera une chute pour toi dans ta vie spirituelle. Donc, je laisserai la place, la parole, je donnerai la parole à la princesse.
Tout a été dit pratiquement. OK, il ne faut pas se marier pour perdre son âme. OK, ça, c'est très, très important. Et puis aussi, il faut prier, être sûr que c'est la volonté de Dieu avant de rentrer dans un mariage. OK? Et le fait que la personne n'a pas de ressources ne veut pas dire qu'on ne va pas l'épouser. OK? Parce que il y a des personnes qui ont beaucoup de faveurs et qui ont été assez chanceux. Et vite, ils ont eu un bon boulot, un business qui a réussi, ou peut-être un héritage de la famille, quelque chose. Ça marche mieux pour eux. Et pour d'autres personnes, ça ne marche pas rapidement. Okay? Ça prend du temps avant qu'ils s'installent dans un peu d'air. Okay? Ça peut prendre un peu de temps pour qu'ils soient un peu à l'aise et qu'ils puissent vraiment s'occuper de vous comme il le faut. Soyez patiente en tant que femme. Et les hommes, il ne faut pas utiliser ça comme une opportunité pour ne rien faire. Essayez sincèrement de travailler et ne pas décider et ne pas penser qu'il y a un travail qui est en dessous de vous, mais de chercher quelque chose quand même. Parce que parfois, dans le peu que vous commencez, que vous décidez de faire, Dieu voit votre fidélité dans le peu et c'est maintenant qu'il pourra vous donner quelque chose de plus. Okay? So God sees the little that you are doing faithfully, and then he gives you more. Okay? Don't ever despise the days of little beginnings. Start somewhere. Don't just sit down and fold your hands and wait for the white collar job. No. Start something. You never know how that little business, that degrading business, that low class business might become a big business tomorrow and you become a millionaire. So don't ever look down on anything that your hands finds to do. Okay. Thank you so much for staying with us.
I also want to warn that brothers should not, you know, have this mentality of the next sister that is well-to-do, I just, you know, go for her because you want to alleviate your situation. I think we'll talk about that in the next topic.
Have a good evening, have a good afternoon, wherever you are in the world. Have a good night, and I'll see you next time. Bye.